G'day, Space Cadets. This is the first in a series of two videos in which the end goal is to discuss and explain a family of hypersonic vehicles called waveriders. Waveriders have been a hot topic in the news recently, and you likely heard them discussed alongside more familiar words such as
China, Russia,
Lockheed Martin.
The general concept of waveriders is relatively simple, but it took me a long time to get my head around the finer details. In order to properly understand wave riders and how they work, we first need to understand the phenomenon called compression lift, which is the focus of this first video. Normally, when we think about aerodynamics and flight, we might imagine an eagle soaring gracefully up high, or an airliner flaring as it comes in for a gentle touchdown. In these examples of subsonic flight, the presence of the body in an airflow can be communicated upstream by gas-particle interactions, allowing the air to follow gently curved streamlines around the body with minimal losses. Supersonic and hypersonic flight requires a different way of thinking. A better analogy here would be Mike Tyson, as hypersonic vehicles function by smashing the air into submission while also destroying any nearby ears in the process. In supersonic and hypersonic flight, the vehicle is traveling faster than the air can communicate to the upstream particles to get out of the way, and so the air piles up, creating shock waves and regions of high pressure and temperature. It's important to note that high pressure regions still occur in subsonic flight, albeit at much lower pressures than in supersonic cases. On an aerofoil, high pressure regions occur at the stagnation point, where the dynamic pressure is converted to static pressure, and on the underside, where pressure gradients are required to generate flow curvature. These subsonic compression processes are isentropic, meaning that the compression happens smoothly and without any losses. The expansion processes which return the air to the ambient pressure are also isentropic. Gas compression and expansion is most efficient when it is done gradually over a large number of small steps. This is why high-efficiency compressors and turbines have many rows of blades, with each providing only a small change in pressure. You can imagine an isentropic process as a hypothetical machine with infinite rows of very narrow, frictionless blades. In supersonic flight, we're traveling too fast for the gradual compression processes that occur in subsonic flight. Instead, shock waves become the main mechanism for gas compression. Across a shock wave, the compression occurs almost instantaneously and in a single step, which is relatively inefficient. The wasted energy goes into additional heating of the fluid and the environment. Both the useful compression energy and the wasted energy must be provided by the vehicle. In practice, the vehicle experiences an additional form of drag, which it must overcome to provide the wasted energy, which we refer to as wave drag. As you might expect, this additional form of drag lowers the aerodynamic performance of supersonic vehicles with respect to subsonic vehicles. A commercial passenger plane typically has a cruising lift-to-drag ratio in the range of 15 to 20, while supersonic aircraft such as the Concorde and the XB-70 Valkyrie had supersonic cruising lift-to-drag ratios of around 6 to 7. In general, as the Mach number is increased, the maximum possible lift-to-drag ratio decreases. While the compression and expansion processes in subsonic and supersonic flow are different, the fundamental principle of lift generation remains the same. A pressure difference must be created across a wing or lifting body. In the subsonic regime, the pressure difference is mainly generated via flow deflection and flow acceleration. In the supersonic regime, the pressure difference is generated by carefully manipulating the shock waves and the post-shock regions. Let's have a closer look. Here we have a thin 2D wedge with a sharp tip in a supersonic flow. Wedges are a surprisingly useful shape for supersonic flight, as well as being easy to analyze. The vertical stabilizer of the X-15 was a simple wedge, and supersonic aerofoils can be just two wedges back to back. This might surprise you given our everyday exposure to commercial aircraft, which typically have blunt noses and complex aerofoils with gentle curves. However, we need to remember that we're considering two different flight regimes. In supersonic flight, a strong normal shock will occur at the tip of the nose, no matter what size or shape the nose is. Normal shocks occur perpendicular to the flow direction, and strongly decelerate the flow while greatly increasing its pressure. Earth re-entry capsules are typically designed with blunt bases which create large normal shock regions and reduce convective heat transfer to the vehicle. The large high-pressure regions create a large drag force, which is not a problem for re-entry vehicles as they need to slow down during re-entry. A large drag force is not beneficial for a hypersonic vehicle, which wants to maintain its high speed. The smaller the leading edge radius, the smaller the normal shock region, and the smaller the pressure drag component from the nose. For this reason, sustained flight hypersonic vehicles have long, thin bodies with very small leading edge radii, which can be idealized as a sharp wedge for the aerodynamic analysis. In this video, we are more interested in the large oblique shock regions occurring above and below the wedge. Oblique shocks form when the flow is deflected in a way that causes the streamlines to converge. We covered this idea in the video on supersonic nozzles, which is worth reviewing if you want to understand this point better. As the flow is only being deflected slightly, rather than completely stagnated, oblique shocks produce only modest pressure increases compared to normal shocks. While the flow after a normal shock is always subsonic, the flow behind an oblique shock can still be supersonic, just at a lower Mach number than it was before the oblique shock. You might be wondering, why are oblique shocks angled? In the case of a normal shock, each vertical slice of the flow learns about the presence of the upcoming flat body all at the same time, when it slams into the high-pressure stagnation region. However, we now have an angled body. A given streamline can't know about the presence of the body until it either impacts the body or the presence of the body is communicated to it by particles in the neighboring streamline. While pressure information can't propagate upstream in supersonic flows, the particles are still interacting with their neighbors and transmitting information at the local speed of sound. The most central streamline will impact the wall, be deflected, and increase its pressure. This increased pressure can be communicated to the streamline above it at the local speed of sound. But remember, the particles are still moving downstream supersonically, and so the pressure communication occurs along a diagonal line, which is our oblique shockwave. Like the normal shock, the gas flow is only affected once it slams into the high pressure region, which in this case is a triangular region above the wedge. The angle of this oblique shock is determined by the wedge angle, the flow speed, and the gas properties. It can be calculated by solving this complicated equation. At the end of the wedge, a phenomenon called expansion fans occur to reduce the pressure and expand the high pressure flow into the empty region behind the vehicle, but this is not of key interest for this video. The expansion fans haven't been included in this animation. Now we're going to see what happens to the oblique shocks, streamlines, and pressure regions as we vary the Mach number, wedge angle, and angle of attack. As we increase the wedge angle, both the flow deflection angle and the oblique shock angle increase. This increases the shock strength and post-shock pressure, and also increases the frontal area of the vehicle exposed to the incoming flow. Both of these effects increase the vehicle's drag, so for hypersonic flight, we want the thinnest vehicle body which can still fit all the components inside. Wedge angles of 5 to 10 degrees are typical. As we increase the speed of the flow, the shock angle decreases. The particles still communicate vertically at Mach 1, but the Mach number in the horizontal direction is getting larger, and so the shock wave gets tilted back. As the vehicle travels faster, the shock gets stronger, creating higher density gas behind the shock in order to accommodate the reduced post-shock volume of smaller shock angles. At large hypersonic Mach numbers, the shock angle approaches a constant value, which depends only on the wedge angle and the gas properties. In Earth's atmosphere, this value is approximately 1.2 times the wedge angle. At the moment, the wedge has a zero angle of attack, and so we have the same post-shock pressure above and below the vehicle. The vehicle is experiencing drag, but not generating any lift. However, if we tilt the wedge, the flow deflection angle above and below become different, which means that we have different strength shocks, and therefore different post-shock pressures above and below the vehicle. Ta-da! We have our all-important pressure difference, which means we have lift. The more we tilt the wedge, the bigger the pressure difference, and the more lift we generate. However, high angles also create high drag, and so most sustained flight hypersonic vehicles operate with flow deflection angles less than about 10 degrees in order to optimize their lift to drag ratio. You might be thinking, hold on a second, if small angles of attack are better, why on earth did the Space Shuttle orbiter fly like this? We need to remember the purpose of the orbiter. Fundamentally, it was a re-entry vehicle. Just like ballistic capsules, it needed to shed its speed, and so high drag was beneficial. The very high angle of attack meant that it could generate significant amounts of lift, even in the thin upper atmosphere, slowing its descent and reducing the peak thermal heating. The fact that it had a low hypersonic lift-to-drag ratio of about 1 in this configuration didn't really matter, as it was trying to slow down anyway. The phenomenon that we have just discussed for the past few minutes is commonly called compression lift. By carefully manipulating the shock waves around a body in a supersonic flow, we have confined the high pressure regions to the underside of the vehicle, while leaving the flow on the upper surface undisturbed and at ambient pressure. Just the same as in subsonic flow, we've created a pressure differential, giving us lift. So far, we have only considered a wedge which is deflecting air vertically. An interesting aspect of compression lift is that the deflecting body, the wedge in this case, doesn't need to be oriented horizontally. The experimental XB70 had a vertically oriented wedge on its underside, which created horizontal oblique shocks. Some of the post-shock gas entered into the engines, while the rest continued to flow along the underside of the wings, creating a higher pressure and more lift than would have occurred otherwise. Now it's disclaimer time. In this introductory video, we have only considered a nice, simple 2D wedge, and we didn't talk at all about 3D or viscous effects. Just like in subsonic flight, complications emerge when we move from 2D idealizations to the real 3D world. The problems that emerge and their solutions will be the main topic of the next video, where we will discuss the XB70 in more detail, as well as waveriders and other lifting body hypersonic vehicles.